Welcome to this presentation about how we built Fjordland with the latest and greatest Next.js adapter from Enonic. I'm Tommy from Tine. I'm a solution architect there. And I have with me Fredrik, who's a front-end developer working on Fjordland and many other sites at Tine. We at Tine have been using Enonic for a while. This was the previous content studio. And we actually launched Tine.no in 2005, so it's almost 20 years ago. It's still going strong. I was there in 2019. We held a presentation that we dubbed Tine.no, world's fastest site on Enonic XP. It's been 5 years. I think we may be back with Fjordland as the world's fastest XP site. We'll have to see. You might be wondering why I'm from Tine and presenting about Fjordland. But Fjordland is actually owned by Tine, 51%. So we handle all their websites and all their IT infrastructure and things like that. So this was the old Fjordland site, built in 2018, 2019, somewhere around that. And they weren't too happy about the web page. It was outdated. It was slow, mobile friendly, not so much. And they wanted to incorporate all their brands into one single page. They had 5 different brands, like Safari Yogurt, which was a separate site built on WordPress or something like that, hosted by another company. So it's a lot of back and forth to make updates to the site. So they wanted to make a multi-brand kind of website. And we also wanted to introduce a design system. We didn't have a design system in Tine until this year. Tine is known for their brand, which looks pretty good. But we're not very good with the digital presence. These are all the kind of buttons we have on our websites. And you might wonder what that button does. So we knew you had to implement a design system, and we wanted all our web pages to use the design system. So together with Figma and Storybook, we created our design system called Creme, which is appropriate since we deliver lots of cream. I'm not sure what Creme stands for, by the way, but Magda is here and can tell us later on. It's not that important. Since we wanted to use a design system, we also had to change our front-end framework because we were using templating in either ThymeLeaf or FreeMarker. And that doesn't go well with React components from the design system. So we had to think about how we would change our tech stack. And then we came up with a couple of criteria. We wanted to focus on the developer experience. Ideally, you wouldn't need to know too much about XP to get a site running, and has to use a modern tech stack. Recruitment was also essentially, either externally or internally, so we could have people from other teams come and join our website team, and they could start working right away. And one of the most important things was we had to integrate with the design system. And training and courses is also nice to know. So we have different options. We could continue using FreeMarker. It's easy for those who've been using Enonic for a while. But the cons are it's hard to use the design system, and the developer experience wasn't that great. Our second option was using React for XP, which do use React, and we can integrate with the design system. But it's still somewhat strange to use inside XP, and you have to like build your site inside XP, and we feel the developer experience is not that great. But the next presentation is about a company that selected this option, so it's nice to see what they come up with. And we went with option C, use Next.js, which lets us integrate with the design system. We feel the developer experience is greater, and it has a low XP footprint, and it's lightning fast, but it does have a few cons. One of them is it's highly complex. You have to have multiple systems running at once, which we'll come back to later in the presentation. So we went with the Next.js, and Frederick will show us a little about how that works.
Yeah, so I will take you through some technical details, and we'll start right at the pointy end with our Next.js setup. We moved away from a traditional CMS approach, where we had, as Tommy explained, our front-end and back-end composed together as a single system, and we moved towards a headless CMS approach. In our new tech stack, we are running Enonic XP as a backend for content. We are using the Guillotine application as a data layer API, and we are using Next.js to power our front-end application. Using Next.js allows us to choose between a few different rendering strategies. First out, we have client-side rendering, where all the JavaScript magic happens here inside the client, and also loading. To shift some of the workload away from the browser, we have server-side rendering, where the page is loaded and rendered on a remote server, but the browser still has to wait for the page to finish before it actually can show anything to the end user. The solution to this is finally static site generation, which we are utilizing through Next.js. Here on build time, the app generates a static HTML file. This file is then stored on the remote server and can be immediately served to the client when the browser requests a page. So this is an example build output from our Next.js app. And what we will talk about here is what is marked with this fill dot icon. This represents SSG, or the static site, static generated content. And as you can see, it consists of almost all of our content. What this means is when our front end builds the app, it iterates through the entire content hierarchy from XP and generates static paths for all the content. This is then pre-rendered as static HTML files. And upon first user request, the HTML is hydrated with the associated JavaScript, and the page is then uploaded to our server cache and can then be immediately served upon coming requests after the first one. And this results in a lightning fast web page. To generate these static paths, we are using a GraphQL query. The benefits of this is that it's highly customizable. We can select what content to include in the response, and we can also select what content to omit from the response. So when we build our front-end application, we have no prior knowledge to how the content will look like or how it's structured. Everything is highly dynamic. And to cater for this, we are utilizing a block component approach. How this works is in the static content, we receive a component, pass it through a block serializer function, which is this one in the screenshot. And with a switch statement, we can iterate through the component. And based on component type, we can pick out the appropriate React component, render the component, and use this to compose our entire web page. Here, we should also notice this draft mode function. This is a Next.js built-in. And what it does is basically check whether draft mode is enabled. We use this value to optimize our image rendering. So for image rendering, we are using the Next.js image component. It comes with built-in support for caching for next-gen image formats, such as WebP, source sets to cater for different viewport sizes. And how it works is that it generates a Next.js internal image URL used in the source. However, in Enonic XP preview mode for the editor, the internal Next.js URL is not available, obviously. So we use the draft value to conditionally render a native HTML image when we are in preview mode to still be able to show the entire view to the editor. All of these measures has allowed us to drastically improve the website performance. So I think the old Fjordland.no was something around 50 in a Google Lighthouse performance score. And as you can see in this Lighthouse screenshot, we have top marks across the board in performance, accessibility, SEO. Also, best practices is quite good, but Google has kindly chosen to punish us for using third-party cookies. Also, the media performance is quite cool with the next image component. Largest contentful paint score, even on a quite large article hero image, is only a quarter of a second. And the layout shift is zero, which is obviously really good. And let's move to the editor side of things with Enonic XP. So this is the standard view, meeting an editor in Content Studio with the preview mode for the selected page. However, this preview mode is not actually our web page. In Content Studio, we have installed the Next XP application. And what this does is when it tries to preview, it passes a request to our frontend. It enables the draft mode. The frontend renders a dynamic version of our web page, which then can be showed to live to the editor. Also, when an editor publishes any changes, the Next XP app utilizes what is called incremental static regeneration. That means when a change is published, it again passes a request to the frontend. It then purges the cache and revalidates the content. So we can show updated content even in a live production app. No need to redeploy or rebuild anything. The Content Studio also comes with a built-in Guillotine query playground, which is a really handy tool. Guillotine is, as I mentioned, the data layer API. And here we can test out, play around with the GraphQL queries and format the JSON content response as we wish to essentially compose what we need for our web page in the end. So when we set up XP, one of our goals was to simplify the editorial experience. And this is what meets our editor when they want to edit an article page at fjordland.no. You may notice there is no right-hand side menu open here. This is because we wanted to take all the organization and layout logic away from XP and move it to the front end. So everything the editor needs to worry about is in the left side menu here. Choose the correct content block, fill in the required content, and our front end will handle everything else.
Yes. So we launched Fjordland, and we started development in November last year, and we finished in June this year, and we waited till after summer with the launch, which didn't have any bigger problems, but there are some lessons that we've learned along the way that might be useful for other people. Build time with the Next.js frontend is quite big. We started at 25 minutes for a complete build, and we got that down to about 12 minutes. One of the bigger tasks is the node modules installation and the packaging the app, also the fetching of the content from the backend. So we've been tweaking this a lot, but I don't know how we're going to get this anywhere in past 10 minutes, unfortunately. So that's something you have to keep in mind if you're developing with Next.js. Logging is also a little bit more complex now, since you have two different back servers running. You have the XP server and you have the Next server. Sometimes you'll see you have to see the log, and the log doesn't say too much, so you have to dig around a little more. The most complex thing about our setup is that we're hosting Next.js ourselves. You could use ourselves, so I think Enonic is doing. We choose to host it ourselves since we have a large organization using Azure Cloud. So we obviously have some memes about that. The third one is the most appropriate one. And one thing we've noticed running Java applications, it's one thing you don't have to think about threads and things like that, but when you're running a node application, It's a single thread application. That means if you have one process running, it can only use the CPU of one thread or one process at a time. So a couple of weeks ago, Fjordland decided to run an ad on Snapchat where they call it a takeover. That means every Norwegian that opens Snapchat would get this ad with a link to Fjordland. They didn't tell us about this. So this is the log from the node process running Fjordland.no. You can see it peaks with 80,000 requests per minute. I think that's about 60,000 users in about a few hours. And you can see this little dip here. That's where we found out we needed to use a process manager for node to even distribute the load between different threads. And the other peak here, we found out we needed even more processors. But once we found that out, we could actually scale pretty well. So we can handle 80,000 requests in a couple of hours. I think that was the end of our presentation.
Perfect timing.
Yeah. Questions or not?
Yes, Thomas.
Yes.
Did you use any of the guillotine extensions, or did you customize kind of what you serve? Did you like use SEO meta fields or these things so you could manage even more?
Yeah, we're using SEO meta fields and sitemap.
Mm-hmm.
Does the build time scale with the number of contents, or is it mostly node modules? You had like 230, but let's say you have 10,000.
I think it does have some correlations, but it's not a linear progression. If we perform the build locally with 230 content, it's maybe 2 minutes. So it's also some Azure processes and exporting content, which takes time.
We do have other internal projects where the number of content is quite much larger than Fjordland, so that's something we'll have to look into once we get there.
I can answer that. What we are what you mentioned, you could control what you actually pre-render as well. So you can just limit it, just render, yeah. Let's say, the most important pages, and also yeah. The other ones are generally just on there.
Because if you have 10,000 pages, that wouldn't make sense to generate them all every time you build.
You mentioned the incremental build after preview per page.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
Does that actually generate a new static per page? I didn't get the details there, so like.
Yeah, when the editor publishes a change, there's a webhook in a Next.xp application, which we have installed. And that purges the cache and generates new static content and revalidates the data to put the new content in the cache. And then again, on the first user request, we have to rehydrate the page, but then we're back to completely finalized web page in the cache and immediate serving.
I can also add a few words for those who are either using the next integration or considering it. We are quite happy with the last version that you guys have used. It seems to be quite stable, but we have started working on the next one, next version of Next, which is going to use the Next.js 15 and the React 19, and then it's going to have the Next image component. Yeah. So you guys will not have to use any workarounds for that.